Good afternoon, everyone. I am Rhonda Smith, the Executive Director of the California Black Health Network, and welcome to our Breast Cancer Awareness Month event, Breast Cancer Clinical Trials in the Black Community. We're really delighted today to have an amazing lineup of individuals to talk about this important topic. Now, we know that increasing clinical trial participation from the Black community, as well as other people of color, is critical to closing the gap in health disparities. It allows researchers to better understand how diseases and treatments affect diverse populations, leading to more accurate, equitable, effective treatments for everyone. In many cases, participating in clinical trials or experimental therapies can be a life-saving option. Now, while we have many stories in our past that may dissuade some of us from participating in clinical trials, like the Tuskegee experiment and the Henrietta Lacks story, rest assured that these occurrences are a thing of the past and that there are patient protections in place today that prevent medical research and the healthcare system from engaging in unethical practices that are unfortunately part of our history. So today you'll hear some great success stories about how clinical trials and medical research have saved lives of people who look like you and me, and from a researcher who works to make sure that we are all included as much as possible in research to help improve outcomes for our community. Before we get started, I'd like to cover just a few housekeeping items. First, unfortunately, Dr. Robina Smith had a work emergency and she is not able to participate today, but I'm very grateful that Dr. Jason Carey from Grail was able to step in at the last minute to save the day. So we'll hear from all the panelists and then there will be an audience Q&A. If you want to say hello or give a shout out to somebody you see here today in the chat box, please do so, but please put your questions in the Q&A box. Also, please note that everyone will remain muted and off camera for the duration of the webinar. So next slide. And before we get started, I'd like to just give an overview of CBHN and who we are for those of you who may be familiar with us who are in attendance today. And so we are a statewide organization that works to advance health equity for Black Californians. Can you go to the next one? Sorry. We conduct outreach, education, policy and advocacy work, as well as programmatic work to ensure that we do close the gap in health disparities. And we do that through the lens of looking at the intersection of health, social justice, racial justice, and environmental justice. Next slide, please. And our vision is to create a California where every African-American and Black immigrant has the opportunity to live a long, healthy life that's free from violence, racism, and health inequities. And we work every day through our mission to ensure that every Black Californian, regardless of how much money they make, how well educated they are, where they live, who they love, how they self-identify, or even where they're from, has the opportunity to access quality, equitable, primary, as well as behavioral health care, and definitely not succumb to diseases, and definitely those that are preventable. So next slide, please. So I'm really excited to get the conversation started today. And our first panelist is Marissa Hall. Marissa is a seasoned leader in the biopharmaceutical industry, and she's worked with many Fortune 500 companies such as GlaxoSmithKline, Abbott, AbbVie, and GE Healthcare, formerly serving as commissioner for the Housing Authority in Los Angeles. And she was appointed by Mayor Garcetti. Marissa currently contributes her wealth of experience as a senior health account executive at Eisai Incorporated. She is a passionate individual and very passionate about healthcare equity and advocates for underrepresented communities, striving to eliminate barriers and ensure fair access to quality healthcare. She actively champions causes related to education, housing, financial literacy, and healthcare, organizing events and collaborating with local organizations to empower children and create sustainable solutions. Beyond her professional and community commitments, Marissa received her executive MBA, congratulations, this year recently from USC, and she is also a CBHN board member. Her inspiring commitment drives her mission to create a better future by addressing healthcare disparities and fostering community engagement. So Marissa, I'll return it over to you to share your story with us today.
Thank you. Thank you, Rhonda. Just before I get started, I just want to do one correction. It's former commissioner, so I don't want anyone to get upset saying, oh, she's not commissioning right now. So I just wanted to correct that. But thank you so much for the introduction. Okay, first I want to just get started. I am a two-time breast cancer survivor. I was diagnosed twice, and then I have to give you the history with that. I was first diagnosed. My first diagnosis was ER positive invasive ductal carcinoma, which means it is estrogen driven. So the cancer grows based on feeding off estrogen. So that was my first diagnosis. And the way I did find out about me having breast cancer is that it was interesting. One day I was wearing a wire bra and it kept sticking me. And it was sticking me where the lump was, and it was a tiny lump. So I was thinking that maybe the wire bra was causing the lump. So I just switched bras and didn't really think anything else about it. Just like, okay, maybe it will just go away because it maybe have been the bra that caused the little lump. So as days went by and weeks went by, it was still there. And I just remember at the time I was dating someone and he kind of mentioned, like, I'm kind of worried about that little lump. You need to get it checked out. And he wasn't really the type of person to really be intuitive enough to go to tell me to go to the doctor. So when he kind of got afraid, it was like his intuition kicked in and that scared me. So I went to the doctors. I did do a mammogram. And because I do have dense breasts, I had to do a 3D mammogram with combination with the ultrasound. And when I did that, the ultrasound found the lump. They told me to come back. And when I did come back, they said, we're gonna have to do a biopsy because it looks like it could be cancerous. They did the biopsy and I found out it was breast cancer. So it was estrogen driven. The stage I was at, I was at stage one. So I was able to catch it early. And because it was invasive, if I did not catch it early, it does spread throughout the body. It would first go into your lymph nodes and then it can go into the bloodstreams and then it could spread throughout the body if you don't catch it early. So luckily I did catch it early. I did decide to get a lumpectomy. That is one of the treatment options for if you have the first stage, and the lumpectomy is the one that removes the tumor and kind of clear out the margins or any cells that are around the tumor so it won't spread. And they also take a couple of your lymph nodes to kind of see what stage you're at. So like I said, I was stage one. During that time, after I received the lumpectomy, I was asked if I was interested in joining a clinical trial. And the clinical trial that I joined was actually for fertility preservation, because at the time that I was diagnosed, I was in my early 30s. I was in my late 30s. I was like 38 when I was first diagnosed. So since I was young and still in childbearing years, they asked if I would be interested in doing this study. And they were looking at African-American women who were interested in fertility preservation before cancer treatments such as chemo or radiation. I did participate in that study. And before I got into the clinical trial, of course, they kind of gave me the rundown and saying there's risk. And because I'm over the age of 35, I was considered geriatric. So they're just telling me that if you're interested in having kids, you probably won't be able to get maybe more than about 5 eggs. So as long as you're okay and there's risk and not every egg that they take is good. So it was a risk because of the cancer was estrogen driven. Everyone knows that when you freeze your egg, they do give you hormone shots, which has some type of estrogen in there. So it was another risk that I had to take, but I was willing to take that risk because I do want kids and I wanted to be able to have kids later after the treatment. So I did, I was able to freeze my eggs, and being part of this trial gave me the opportunity to be monitored more. So when you do participate in clinical trials, you get frequent monitoring and you get access to resources and specialists that I don't know if you would get the same type of access if you weren't participating in a trial. So I did participate, and it ended up being a successful trial for me. And I was able to not only retrieve 5 eggs, but they really retrieved 22 eggs. So I have like 22 eggs in storage right now. I just, after I did freeze my eggs, I did have to go into the other treatment options for the cancer. So I did do radiation for 4 months. And then they took my case to the tumor board. And the tumor board is when a couple of doctors are deciding the next treatment if your doctor is unsure exactly what to do. So they get kind of a conversation with their peers to make a decision. So they were going back and forth if I needed chemo or not because I was at stage one. They opted me to get chemo, so I just did the radiation. And when I did the radiation, the side effects that I did get from the radiation was the fatigue. The fatigue was really, really, really bad. And I always describe fatigue as if you drive and you're really sleepy driving, and it doesn't matter if you roll down the windows, if you turn on the music, you're still like looking at the lines and still dozing. That's how bad the fatigue was. So it was hard for me to function. So I always had to schedule my appointments at the end of the day so I can just go home and go to sleep. And so I did that for 4 months. After I got through that, I was on tamoxifen. And tamoxifen is a preventative treatment that they give people with breast cancer who was ER positive, which stops the estrogen in your body. And you got to take it for 5 to 10 years. Because I had to take it for 5 years, you're infertile. So you're not able to have kids. So me participating in the study helped me freeze my eggs at that age. Moving forward, after the 5 years, I was celebrating being cancer-free and actually going through 5 years of breast cancer, and then got diagnosed again. So what happened at that time, I guess the margins weren't clear. They end up finding a cluster in the same area. And it was a stage one going on stage two. And my options at that moment was a lumpectomy, but because it was reoccurrence, it was a mastectomy. And that is the removal of the breast at that time on my left side. So that was a hard decision to even get through or bring your mind around to even knowing that you have to remove your breast. But if it's has to do with your life, you're gonna say, okay, remove it. So that was what I decided to do. And before I went into surgery, I did ask a couple of my peers their thoughts about me having the mastectomy on the left side and what are their thoughts on the right side. So what happens to the other side? Do I have to go? Is it going to spread to that side in the future or later on? What's going to happen? And I had mixed reviews. Some people say do both. One, just do the left side. So when I was in surgery and before I went under, I just told them to do both. And that's what happened. So I did get a bilateral mastectomy on both sides, the removal of both breasts. And when I did come back, I just found out that I should have had chemo the first time. And if I would have had chemo the first time, the chances is I would have probably had to go through it again. The margins weren't clear and the chemo would have done that. But the doctor at the time told me that you're okay, that you're not gonna need chemo. So this time they had to do the radiation afterwards, but I did remove the breast, but I didn't have to do chemo this time. It's because there was no breast there for me to do chemo. So that is basically the story of my journey. But during the clinical trials, I did get support from the healthcare community as well as my own community. And you meet a lot of women who are going through the same thing that you're going through. So you do have that emotional support and speaking with women who've done the same. In clinical trials, I know there is a stigma thinking that you have to be really ill in order for you to participate in a trial. But in the clinical trials, there you can be in all stages. You can be at beginning stages to late stages to participate in clinical trials. So I just decided, because I wanted to save my eggs, but there are so many different trials out there. And I just am a believer of trying clinical trials, but I would think that I would hope that you would talk to your physician about it first and just make sure, are you a candidate and a participant, that be a candidate for that trial, and kind of look at all your options before participating. But I did have benefits being participating in it.
Great, Marissa. I have actually quite a few questions to ask, but I will reserve them for the Q&A segment. But thank you so much for being here today and for sharing your story and participating in the webinar today. So next, I would like to introduce Dr. Jason Carey. Dr. Carey is a senior medical science liaison at Grail, with over a decade of oncology and molecular diagnostic experience. So as a medical science liaison at Grail, Dr. Carey is responsible for educating physicians and the community on the benefits of multi-cancer early detection technology. And I will leave it to him to explain to you exactly what that is and what that entails. But he also focuses his career on improving the ability of cancer patients to both survive and thrive against cancer by first investigating novel treatment therapies to improve patient outcomes with Grail, and finding other cancers at their earliest possible time when patients are more likely to survive. So early detection is definitely the key to survival. So last, with a focus on health equity and clinical implementation, Dr. Carey is challenged with bringing this technology to patients and populations that need it the most. So Jason or Dr. Carey, I'll turn it over to you to talk about your experience actually leading some clinical trials. If you wanna share the information about the Grail technology, that would be great. But I think it's important for our community to hear why it is important for us to participate in clinical trials and what that entailed, and any other pertinent information you think is important to share about this as an option for individuals.
Thank you, Rhonda. And first I have to say, just call me Jason. You know that we've had a number of these sessions. And
I know, yes.
you can't get too big for your britches. And at the end of the day, we're here to have a discussion. And like you, Rhonda, I have questions for Marissa, because that was powerful. And I want to thank her for sharing that story. And when we get to the Q&A component, I'd love to, you know, hear more about her story, because quite frankly, I find what I do boring compared to what she goes through and what thousands, if not millions, of women are going through on an everyday basis when it comes to not only breast cancer, but every other type of cancer. But in the interest of why we're here, I do have to say, my qualifications or, you know, where I started. And at the end of the day, I got into this because I needed a reason to wake up in the morning. And it started off in undergrad, and I just loved research. And that led me to a career in cancer research. I did my PhD in prostate cancer with a focus on health disparities of African-American men and looking at the systemic barriers that equate to the differential outcomes. But I was really motivated by a higher power when I was finishing up my research to shift over to breast cancer. And that's because, if you hear a slight accent, I'm originally from the Bahamas. And at the time I was finishing up my PhD research, it was discovered that women from the Bahamas have one of the highest rates of BRCA mutations. And as I heard that story, I wondered about genetic testing, because we're only just on the cusp of understanding, you know, how our genes, how our DNA really influence who gets cancer and who really responds to the types of treatments that are out there. And it was on that path that led me to first, you know, develop these drugs. When I started on that path, finishing up my PhD, there were only 10 drugs that were FDA approved for breast cancer. In a little over a decade, we doubled that. There are now 22. And I've been fortunate enough to actually work on some of those drugs that are now FDA approved. And this is where clinical trials come in. to get FDA approval, those drugs that I worked in a lab, in a dark room, just me and some cells trying to understand how they work, now are being treated in patients and improving outcomes because there were patients like Marissa that were brave enough to participate in the clinical trials that led to the FDA approval. And so in both a selfish and motivating effort, I have to say we need everybody's participation for clinical trials because that's what leads to doubling the number of drugs that improve outcomes. But I'm also going to say something else. If we as a people don't participate in these clinical trials, we don't actually know if these drugs work for us. And that's why it's important to have that inclusivity across all races, across all racial groups, because you can have a drug that works really good in one population and you're doing it in a clinical trial and it looks good. And you know what they found in the past? Sometimes they didn't enroll enough Blacks. They didn't enroll enough Asians. They didn't enroll enough Hispanics. And they find a differential in how those drugs work. This happened with ACE inhibitors to where it was discovered that those drugs that were designed for high blood pressure, they don't work as well in African-Americans. And that's because they weren't included in the clinical trials. But getting back to breast cancer, we're really on the cusp of not only revolutionizing like and improving the outcomes, but also in just understanding the disease. Over the past year, there have been significant advances in terms of approvals for new studies. And I'm talking specifically about studies. One that I would like to link to is really the Voices of Black Women study by the American Cancer Society that's going to look at 100,000 Black women aged 25 to 55 and follow them for 30 years to understand why is it that Black women have higher rates of mortality, don't respond to the same treatments. There was another recent approval of a $25 million grant that's being shepherded by a group out of Morehouse that's going to look at the genetic and societal factors of Black people from the US, the UK, and Africa to really understand what is that molecular basis. And so we do have to acknowledge that we need everyone's help in this effort, but we also have to remember how did we get to this point of where we're seeing low enrollment for minorities in clinical trials. And we have to look at both the Tuskegee study as well as Henrietta Lacks to understand there is deserved mistrust in the medical community. And the only way we can improve or get the participation of all groups is both recognizing what has happened, but also looking to improve upon those efforts. And, you know, not to gloss over those facts, but we know that the Tuskegee Airmen were used as test subjects that ended up in a scenario where they were viewed as less than and weren't afforded the same regulation that should have been afforded to them as human beings. The Henrietta Lacks story poses how often the medical community can end up taking advantage of individuals. That's quite frankly not fair. But this is where we need communication. We need understanding so that we know that in structured clinical trials, there are very important and regulated frameworks such as institutional review boards, FDA guidelines that have now fit the framework to make sure everybody enrolled in a clinical study gets the same fair and balanced treatment and access to not only the treatment of drugs, but also the care associated with participating in a clinical trial. And I'm going to talk about something that I don't often hear highlighted, and that is that, yes, the U.S. is made up of a majority white population, but we're very much headed towards a minority majority population. Talking about Blacks, Hispanics, Asians will make up the majority of the U.S. population by approximately 2044, anywhere from 2040 to 2046. What happens when all of these drugs that have been approved on large majority white populations are being given to a large non-white population. And so that may not be us, but it's our children, it's our grandchildren. And so again, this is why it is important that we participate and we understand our role and responsibilities for the future generations in participating in these clinical trials. And just to shine a spotlight on that, minorities make up about 40% of the population. When we look at it, especially Blacks and African Americans, they're about 13 to 14%. In clinical trials across the US, Blacks represent about 5 to 7% of participation in clinical trials, right? So we need more participation. In addition, a study in 2020 found that the total number of participants in a clinical study was 75% white, 25% all other populations, which is greatly not aligned with the US population. And so when you hear in the news, this drug was FDA approved, that drug was FDA approved, and these are seen as the greatest advancements in medical care, you should scrutinize that. Who was a part of the population that this study was approved for? And I encourage everyone to both understand, but also participate in those efforts. But going back to something that Marissa said, it's very important to have a supportive community, whether that's from your medical community, your physician, whether that's your close circle. And something that you'll realize, and it's something that I had to realize, is that a little bit of knowledge goes a long way. Marissa is now an expert to anybody undergoing a cancer diagnosis because she has a wealth of knowledge that somebody can learn from. I'll wrap up a little bit of my context with this example. I had a friend from high school that I hadn't spoken to in about 20 years reach out to me yesterday morning. And I'm in Texas, so I was actually enjoying it. It was a great morning. I woke up and I was enjoying the fact that we actually hit 60 degrees in Texas, which, if you know anything about Texas, is in and of itself a miracle. But as I'm enjoying my morning, I get a message from somebody I haven't spoken to in 20 years, reaching out to me. They say, I understand. I know you're an expert on cancer. My mother just got this diagnosis. Could you help me? And she sent me the radiology report of what was on the imaging, the proposed diagnosis. And she asked for my help in just understanding what this meant. And we spent some time and discussed it. And I laid out everything that I knew, but I encouraged her to seek guidance from other physicians. But when we were done, she said she was very thankful because what she said was the physician that gave her the diagnosis didn't explain any of that. And so I'm only saying that to say there is always another option in terms of you should understand what is going on with you, what is going on with your body. And it's when you're empowered to understand that you can seek additional options like clinical trials. And so lastly, I will highlight, as Rhonda talked about, I function right now in a space that's on the cutting edge, in a space that where we're trying to expand how we screen for all types of cancers with a blood draw. And the one thing that has taught me is that we all have to be involved in not only our health, but in understanding the advancements of technology. If I was to tell you to do this clinical trial, you would probably look at me skeptically. But if I would say, hey, try next year's iPhone today, you would be more than elated to do that. And so in a lot of cases, I want you to think of these clinical trials as the iPhone 24, something that's not out yet, that you don't necessarily, everybody doesn't have access to, but it can be an incredibly powerful tool. But in this case, make a difference in saving someone's life. And even if it's not necessarily, some studies are just observational studies, that information in and of itself could be hugely beneficial to someone else down the road. And so I think I'm right at about time, Ron, so you can let me know.
Yeah, great, Jason. I have questions for you too, so I'm really looking forward to the Q&A and having that dialogue with you. So thank you so much for sharing all that information. There are some medical terms that we can clarify later, but I think all that you said was really important for our audience to hear today. And hopefully that will encourage them if they're confronted with a situation where clinical trial may be the only alternative or the best alternative, then they'd be more open and receptive to doing so. So thank you very much. Okay, so next up is Christina Carr Van Dunk. She is a marketing leader for Kaiser Permanente, where she serves as a thought partner, strategist, and advisor to senior leaders. With 30 years of experience in communications, stakeholder engagement, and leadership, Christina drives results through establishing credibility, demonstrating expertise, and developing relationships with key stakeholders, ranging from C-suite executives to external partners. She is passionate about initiatives aimed at ending disparities in healthcare for people of color that exist within our healthcare system. She's mostly devoted to the call of God that has placed her in life as a 15-year pancreatic cancer survivor. So I'll talk about that in just a second. But despite living with an active cancer for the past 15 years, she has learned to live and really be in charge of her situation and thrive despite what we normally hear about patients diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. So she wholeheartedly believes that her cancer diagnosis is not a curse, but rather an opportunity to share the power of faith, hope, and determination and resilience, even in the face of difficulty. And so I could say and go on and on and on about Christina, but what I really want to say is that, you know, when I met her, I was wowed by her. I call her a unicorn and a miracle. And very rarely do we see someone like us or anyone live for 15 years with a pancreatic cancer diagnosis. And while I know the topic is breast cancer today, I felt it was important for our community to see someone like Christina, who actually is here because of an experimental treatment that she was presented the opportunity to benefit from 15 or more years ago. And so with that, I'll turn it over to Christina to share her story about her journey.
Thank you so much, Rhonda, for the warm introduction. And I will say it's actually been 13 years, but I love that you said 15. I'm going to go ahead and claim that and receive that right now. So it is just truly a pleasure to be on this panel today and to speak with you all. Health equity is a passion of mine. And by way of being a cancer survivor and thriver, I like to say, because I definitely want to do more than survive, this is also a very passionate topic for me. And so I'll share my journey with you, and then I'll also share with you the importance of clinical trials and the role that the drug therapy that I was offered helped create in terms of saving my life. So I'll take us back to 2011. 2011. I was living the dream in terms of work, very high pressure job, traveling every week, but so fulfilled. At Kaiser Permanente at the time, I was the leader of communications for health policy, community health, national diversity, and national research. And so it was a very demanding and stressful role, but nothing could have been more fulfilling to me. I felt it almost felt like ministry, the work that we were doing. However, I was also raising a family. My husband and I had two teenagers in high school, and the travel and the work responsibilities combined with family and life, I thought was taking a toll on me. I thought that is why I was so extremely tired. I was dealing with severe lower back pain, a number of GI issues, inability to keep food down, nausea, you name it. And I thought, well, I'm just very busy and I'm very stressed. Nevertheless, I would visit emergency rooms half a dozen times that year. In and out of the hospital, doctors were not clear about what was going on with me. We thought at one point it was irritable bowel syndrome because it was a lot going on with my GI tract. Other times they said, oh, well, you've got this old bulging disc. That must be the source of your pain. After a year of this, unfortunately, in August of 2011, I was diagnosed with terminal stage 4 pancreatic cancer. I was told that I had perhaps 3 to 6 months at most to live. This was beyond devastating, as you can imagine. All I could think of is not seeing my children graduate high school or go to college or get married, celebrating my next anniversary, seeing my godchildren grow up. All of my life literally flashed before me, and I was terrified. Yet at the same time, something in me would not allow me to accept the death sentence that I had just been provided with. I was told that there were no treatment options and that I would be prepared to be removed and taken to hospice, which is where they take you to make you comfortable right before you die. I couldn't accept that. And I escalated and pushed back and asked lots of questions and would not accept the outcome that had been given to me. My faith encouraged me to hold on and know that miracles were possible. And for every no, there had to be a yes. And so after doing that, and had to do that very quickly because I had a terminal diagnosis, I was given an angel of an oncologist, Dr. Tim Grennan, who is retired now, but we're still in communication. And he said, you know what, Christina, everybody that has told you there are no options has been mostly correct. However, there is one possible option. There is a new drug that is just out of clinical trials. And because of my work with Kaiser Permanente, I was familiar with clinical trials, but I'd never known anyone that looked like me that had participated or even been offered to participate in a clinical trial. He said, there's this drug, it's called Everlimus. It's also known as Afinitor. Now, we have no longitudinal evidence that suggests this will help extend your life. We don't know that it would work, but it has performed really, really well in clinical trials. And with that, he handed me a packet to read. And I took that packet, my husband and I studied it. We researched a lot. We called him, asked a ton of questions. And the way I saw it, there weren't really other, I had nothing to lose, right? They had already given me a death sentence and told me that within a matter of months, I would be gone. And so with my knees trembling and shaking, I said, yes, I will go for it. I will take advantage of this drug just out of clinical trials. Well, I would remain on Everlimus for 8 years. And to this date, I just celebrated my 13th cancer anniversary of the diagnosis of my cancer in August. Now, it's important to note, I have never been declared cancer-free. I have an active tumor, and I am still in treatment. I am currently doing immunotherapy with a drug called Keytruda that I've been on for 4 years, that they told me I could try for maybe 6 months and we'd see how it would do. But I was also told, even with the immunotherapy, that this is not for pancreatic cancer. And to that, I said, what is for pancreatic cancer? You know, there aren't many options available. You know, the survivorship for pancreatic cancer is not good at all. So I've learned to be very courageous and fearless in the fight for my life. I, as Rhonda said, recognize that there is, while this is a burden that I would not wish upon anyone living with active cancer, it is also an opportunity to help others. I speak with cancer patients regularly all over the world. I have an Instagram page that I share my journey. And people reach out almost weekly with their cancer stories. And my message is really threefold. And that is one, to really control your thoughts, to have a positive mindset and an outlook, and really belief and hope that there are possibilities beyond a cancer diagnosis. The second thing I would say is to really remember that there is much that we could do upstream, really, in terms of prevention and how we take care of ourselves, what we eat. Nutrition matters. Exercise matters. Stress management matters. Getting enough sleep and rest. These things all contribute to a healthy life, which puts you in a better position to hopefully avoid cancer. But even if you get it, it puts you in a better position to fight. Despite the diagnosis, the rest of my body was very healthy. And while I was still young, only 41 years old, I was in good shape to fight back, even though it was a terminal diagnosis. So do your part. The other part I would also say is never stop advocating. As Jason pointed out, if you don't understand, ask questions. Be your own advocate. Ask what other treatment options are available to you. And don't necessarily accept that there is nothing that can be done. Get a second, third, and a fourth opinion. Sometimes it means getting a different doctor, a doctor that seems more invested in your health and your life. And so those things really make a difference. Advocating for yourself, taking care of yourself. And of course, for me, also deep, deep faith. My faith is what grounds me. And that's what faith in God does. For me, there are things in life, like a cancer diagnosis, that are just bigger than us. There are some things that you cannot control. And there seems to be nothing that you can do. And for me, that's where my faith comes in. I can hand this over and then go back to doing my part, but knowing that there is a higher power, that God is got the final say in what happens to me. So I just really appreciate the opportunity to come here to share my story. And I hope and pray to encourage someone to not give up. And most importantly, you know, they can't design medication protocols and treatments for us if we are not participating in the clinical trials. We're not participating in the research that's being done. And we certainly have reasons to be fearful, but we also have reasons to be hopeful. So when you think about clinical trials and you think about the world of healthcare and all those scary feelings come up, you know, remember my face, remember Marissa's face, and hopefully that will give you the inspiration and the courage to keep going. So thank you for this time.
So great. Thank you so much, Christine. I really, again, appreciate you being here and sharing your story. And I talk about you often, and I know, you know, I connected you to a very dear friend of mine who was recently diagnosed with pancreatic cancer, so that she could be hopeful about her situation and live, you know, for 15 more years. She's a very important part of my life and is like a sister to me. So thank you for that.
That's my mantra, live. That's what we're going to do.
Yeah, exactly. So I want to pick up where you left off, Christina, talking about, you know, advocating for yourself and, also having faith. So two things there. You know, we are also hosting a series called Making the Healthcare System Work Better for You. And one of the things that we will talk about actually at our next session is how to advocate for yourself and your loved ones, especially if you're confronted with a serious health diagnosis and especially in your situation. So can you talk a little bit about how you actually did advocate for yourself and what did you learn about doing that? And if you could share some tips for the audience today about how to do that successfully.
Yes, I think it was desperation, first of all, that kind of fueled me. You know, I really didn't want to die. And there was just, I was raised by a very strong woman who I also saw break barriers But it was just asking questions. Well, why aren't there any options? Doing my own research and coming back and saying, well, you say there are no options, but I did some research and I discovered there's something called the Whipple surgery that is done for pancreatic cancer patients. You know, surprising looks in the room. Oh, you know about the Whipple surgery? I do. So can we talk about that? That prompted them to do some further looks, and I was evaluated. They did biopsies, all sorts of things. Unfortunately, I was not a candidate for the Whipple surgery because of the way my tumor was, and there were arteries actually wrapped around the tumor. So had they cut into that, I would have bled out within seconds. And so the Whipple surgery, and no one talked to me about the Whipple surgery though. That was me doing my own legwork and research. And so that's what I would say is, leave no stone unturned. Get online, do your research, make your calls. If you know, as Jason pointed out, a friend reached out to him yesterday. If you know physicians, if you have friends in the medical field, ask. I mean, I was fortunate. I worked with executive leadership at our company. So those were some of the calls that were being made on my behalf as well. And I recognize that's a true privilege. Everybody doesn't have that access to senior leadership in healthcare organizations. And the reality is it shouldn't take that. We shouldn't have to have that kind of access. Recognize that there is racial bias in healthcare. Unfortunately, there really is. And don't let that discourage you. Don't get angry about it. Get smart about it. Meet that where it is and show up in the room. Ask questions. Bring people with you. In the beginning, I was so devastated. I couldn't almost even hear what they were saying. So I would always have my husband or my best friend or my mom, a loved one, taking notes. And I swear they would hear things that I never heard. To this day, I have to go back to ask my husband, what medication did I take in the third year? What did that doctor say in the fifth year? Didn't I take this medication before? So don't go it alone. You don't have to. There are people that love and want to support you. But if you're like me, you have trouble asking for help, don't be that person. So I would just say, use all of your resources, do your own homework, and don't be intimidated by the medical system. This is your life and it's worth fighting for.
Thank you so much for saying that. Yeah. So Jason, I was just about to come to you, and the point there, yeah, being a well-informed patient and doing your homework. But when you do search for information, we have to make sure that we are using credible sources and not just anything on the internet. So I wanted to make that point. And then Jason, you talked about being an empowered patient, and obviously Christina is just that, but do you want to elaborate on that a little bit more and whatever you were about to comment on?
Well, exactly. It's on along the same lines, and this is something that I try to make everyone aware that's had a cancer diagnosis, and it's that your cancer has its own DNA, just like everyone will submit to 23andMe or Ancestry to figure out where you're from. Your cancer actually has its own DNA that is potentially different from your everyday DNA. And the drug that Christina had is a targeted drug, meaning that it works on specific factors that are only prevalent in certain types of cancer. And what you have now with understanding your cancer's DNA is that there are specific drugs that may only work on your specific type of cancer, independent of whether or not it's pancreatic or it's breast or, you know, lung or something along those lines. And so, but this is something that where for most people, if your doctor doesn't bring it up, they don't know about it or they're not going to do it. And in most cases, it's covered by insurance, but it's definitely something that should be done.
Great. Thank you. And can you speak a little bit more about something that you mentioned really piqued my curiosity, because you said ACE inhibitors don't really work well in African Americans. First of all, can you describe what they are and what we've learned about that as a hypertension drug? Is that what you said?
Yeah. Yes, for high blood pressure. And so being in oncology, not my greatest area of expertise, but we do know from a demographic standpoint that Essentially, ACE inhibitors were a drug that were FDA approved and seen to lower blood pressure amongst a general population. When they started giving it to the general population and they went and looked back at the studies and the data, they realized that, and this happened after the drug was FDA approved, that it just was not that effective in the African American population. And so again, this is a targeted drug designed to lower the blood pressure. And for whatever reason, the enzyme is just blocking the enzyme is just not that effective in the African American population.
Right. And so there were situations where people were prescribed this medication and still had trouble managing their blood pressure. So I think this is a good lesson for why it's important for us to participate in clinical trials, especially when we look at hypertension, because we know that is very prevalent in the Black community. And we also know that oftentimes there are a lot of people who are walking around that don't realize they have high blood pressure. So this is an important thing to know and be part of. And
But I want to highlight what you said just now, and one of the problems in what you said is that there was mistrust in that association between the patient and the doctor, to where they're being prescribed a drug. The patient could have been taking that drug as prescribed daily, but their blood pressure isn't dropping. They go back to the doctor. The doctor's making an assumption that the patient isn't taking the drug or isn't doing what they need to do because the study doesn't say that it doesn't work as well in this population. And so this goes back to where those wrinkles from the very beginning, as simply as the design of a clinical trial, can then later go on to cause mistrust between that doctor and the patient later on. And so it just goes to show how that kernel or that issue from the very beginning can be hugely impactful for millions of people later on. And what the way we see it manifest is that the patient thinks their doctor doesn't believe them. The doctor thinks, my African American patients, I can't get them to take their drugs, even though I prescribed them. So yeah, it's just a vicious cycle.
great. Thank you for that, Jason. I see we do have one question in the chat. And the first question looks like maybe a few questions from this person. How can site management organizations like Horizonte actively contribute to reducing the underrepresentation of Black communities in breast cancer trials, both in the US and the UK? I don't know, Jason, if you want to take that one.
In response to that question, I have so many viewpoints on this, but I don't think it's a one size fits all, because for different people, there are going to be different reasons why either they're not participating in clinical trials. It could be anywhere from, honestly, a lot of people are in today's day and age are just trying to make it and get by. And so they don't have really the luxury of participating in clinical trials. They don't have access to get to medical centers where those clinical trials may be. They are not knowledgeable about their opportunities or their options. And so I think it's very individualized. And I think that's where, for effective clinical trials, I think clinical trials should strive to be nationally, internationally, wherever it's applicable. I think even within one city center, there should also be central sites for the clinical trial, as well as rural sites. And so I think there are multiple components. But another thing that I don't think is as well researched and understood is the communication level. How do we reach people where they're at? Right? That's something to say you want African Americans in your clinical trial. What have you done? Have you gone into that population? Have you advertised in the areas where they absorb their music, their entertainment, et cetera? And so I don't think it's a one size fits all. In fact, I think within just, if we were to just take a microcosm of one city center for one clinical trial, there are at least probably 15 different things that you could try to help improve engagement and understanding of clinical trials for underrepresented populations.
Great, thank you very much. And then the second question that this person has is, what potential opportunities do you see for collaboration between organizations like Horizonte in the UK and research institutions in the US to enhance clinical trial accessibility and improve diversity? I think you kind of addressed that, spoke to that, but I don't know if there's anything else that you would like to add.
The my true and I'm a I'm both an optimist as well as a wishful thinker, and I think that there should be, you know, third party organizations that really control access to these clinical trials. And the reason I say third party is, from my visibility, everybody has skin in the game. When it comes to a drug, the drug company wants the drug to be as approved as quickly as possible. When you have the academic or the site, they're being paid to have that clinical trial at their location. And so they may have different motivations. The patients obviously have their motivation. They want to do better. It's really, if you could have like a third party or independent proponent that is advocating for everybody's best interest, I honestly think that would be the best case, but that's something that doesn't necessarily exist. But what I would say is, whatever side you're on, you need to understand the motivation for the other side, but take that in kind to objectively get to a common shared endpoint goal, which in most cases is the approval of the drug, right? If we're talking about drug clinical trials. And so that would be essentially my advocate, is that understanding not just your side of the equation, but the other side. And that can also often help you understand the bias associated that may not be in your best interest. And from a patient standpoint, as to why not participate in that clinical trial or this clinical trial.
Great, thank you very much. So someone does have some questions about MCED, and Jason, if you don't mind speaking to that. So they wanna know specifically, what makes this test so innovative? Is it currently available in the general market, and what is the typical cost, and is it covered by health insurance plans? So
yeah,
you handle all those questions.
So this is what's known as multi-cancer early detection. For decades now, from mammograms, we have been screening for single cancers at a time, right? What most people don't understand, or what Christina is probably very well adept at, there's no screening for pancreatic cancer unless you have a genetic genetic association with pancreatic cancer. There's no screening for stomach cancer in the general population. There's no screening for head and neck. 70% of the cancers we're diagnosed each year, we're not screening for. We only have 5 single cancer screenings. And so I left academia and came to industry because, quite frankly, I got tired of seeing stage 4 late stage diagnosis. What you have with this technology is an opportunity to detect pancreatic cancer in early stage, where you're doing one blood draw, and instead of knowing that somebody like Christina is going to be diagnosed with pancreatic, you don't have to know. The test in itself will figure out which cancer we should be screened for in at once. And so that's really what the technology is. What makes it groundbreaking is that it is DNA-based, but it's looking at a layer of DNA we had never interrogated before. It's what's known as the epigenetic or methylation layer of the DNA. And even though we've sequenced the human genome a few decades now, we're still unlocking secrets that we never even knew existed. And so this just goes to show the potential for our innovation is still limitless at this standpoint. But for right now, it's an opportunity to make a dent into 70% of those cancers that we're not diagnosing. It is publicly available. It's not right now covered by insurance. And so the one thing I will say, to do your research, the test is called Gallery. It's a multi-cancer test. It's been demonstrated in clinical trials to detect over 50 different types of cancer, but it's something that can only be ordered by a physician. So it's not something that you should be seeking the path on your own. You should be talking to your primary care provider. And if you don't have a primary care provider, you need to get one, because there's a lot more important things you should be doing as opposed to this test. That should not be the only thing that you should be concerned about. I want you equally concerned about diabetes, high blood pressure, cardiovascular disease. That can all be addressed through an annual physical. And so it's great. It's innovative technology. But what one of the things that I'm equally advocate for is, let's get our entire health in check in the process.
Thank you, Jason. And so, Marissa, a quick question for you. So you talked about fertility preservation, which I think is important, especially when we think about Black women who are under 40 who get diagnosed with maybe triple negative or some other type of breast cancer. So can you talk about whether or not the conversation about doing that was something that you initiated it? Was that something that your care team or your health provider that you were working with actually initiated? Like, how did that come about? And then because you participated in the clinical trial, was that covered? Because I know oftentimes that could be a little bit expensive, and I'm not sure that insurance actually covers that. So can you speak to that a little bit for people in the audience who may be curious about how that works?
Sure. Yes. I wanted to, I know Leah had a question about me having reconstruction surgery, so I just want to answer her question. Yes, I did. So to answer your question, Rhonda, how that conversation came about, I had the conversation. I initiated the conversation because I still was in childbearing years and I still wanted to have kids. So I was wondering, okay, what does the effect of chemo do if I wanted to have kids moving forward once the treatment's over? What does tamoxifen do if I wanted to have kids? So being on a drug like tamoxifen, they did tell me that you're going to be infertile for 5 years. So I was wondering if there's a possibility to save my eggs. And then there, at the time, they didn't know of a study. So they told me, yes, you can, but the cost was probably like almost $25K just to freeze your eggs at the time. And me being under 30, I didn't have that. So then we came across a study, and there's a way you can find out what studies are going on clinicaltrials.gov. You can kind of figure out the different studies that are out there. And they did, we found a study, and it was just perfect timing when it happened. And that's how I was able to freeze. So I initiated the conversation.
So yes, and also I think that's a great example of being an empowered patient, right? And taking charge mm-hmm. of your health and well-being. So that was great. And knowing that you can really direct and participate in the decision-making for your care and be at the center of that. And can you repeat the web address again for people who are interested in finding out if there are clinical trials available, if they should be interested in one?
Yes, it's clinicaltrials.gov. Clinical trials, all one word, .gov.
Okay.
And to also answer your question regards to cost, mm-hmm. At the time it was sponsored by a pharmaceutical company that studies, so the cost was covered, but not all clinical trials are covered by pharmaceutical companies or sponsored by pharmaceutical companies. And like Jason stated, some are designed and they're not. So you got to really check with your health insurance, because sometimes you may have to do a copay cost if you consistently get screened or treatments throughout the duration of the study. Studies can range from 6 weeks to 5 years. So you may want to kind of make sure financially that is covered and have that conversation. If I were to participate, what is covered? What is my out-of-pocket expense? So, and you can really just make sure you really have that conversation and be clear about it, so there's no surprises. But not all clinical trials could be covered, but there are some that aren't.
Thank you very much. And there is an organization, a nonprofit organization out there that actually helps patients and supports patients financially when they're enrolled in clinical trials, and that's the Lazarus Foundation. So just an FYI for those of you in the audience who may need that information. So I want to thank you all again for participating, taking the time out of your busy calendars to be here. Really appreciate sharing your stories and helping our community better understand more about clinical trials, why it's important for us to participate, and how that benefits us as a community and can impact health outcomes. So thank you very much. I'm going to ask Sylvie to reshare the slide deck so that we can wrap up and move on. And so for those of you that are still here, please let us know what you think about the session today. If you can scan the QR code and give us your feedback, we really value your input. It helps us know if we're doing the right thing in the right way, and also helps us to improve so that we can hit the mark on the education webinars that we're doing. Sylvie, I think, is also going to put it in the chat. So you have two opportunities, and we'll make sure that we follow up with you to, in case you missed the opportunity now, and for those who have already left. Okay. So next slide, please. And then don't forget that if you attend all five of the How Do I session webinars, some of you here today may have been participating in our How Do I five-part series. You can enter to win a $100 Visa gift card. So we will draw for the lucky winner after the November 25th session, or sorry, 21st session. So please, if you've attended all three so far, you've got one more next week, and then the one in November to register and participate. Next slide, please. And then we have a few upcoming events this month and next month. So for making the healthcare system work better for you, we have a session on November 20th. That's an in-person in Inglewood called Cocktails and Conversations at Drobe Stogies. It's a cigar bar, a Black-owned cigar bar in Inglewood. On November 21st, we've got session 5 for the making the healthcare system work better for you. It is how to participate in the decision-making for your care. We saw some really great examples of that today. We have a health equity forum coming up on November 14th, featuring Dr. David Carlisle, talking about improving workforce development for improving health outcomes. And then we have an in-person Black Health Network member networking event in Orange County on October 26th. And so all the information to register is available on our website. If you go to cablackhealthnetwork.org, under the events tab, you'll see all the current events listed in the drop down menu. And I think that is it for me today. Thank you all, everyone who participated and attended today. Really appreciate you being here and supporting us in our work. And you can stay connected with us. Obviously, you can sign up for our mailing list through our website. You can follow us on social at your CBHN. With the exception of LinkedIn and actually I think on YouTube, it's the company name. And then you can also join us and support us in our work through the Campaign for Black Health Equity. So again, all of this is accessible through our website. So thanks a lot for being here and have a great rest of the day. Take care.
Thank you, bye-bye.